I'm Peter Brown from Tiny & Sons Glass. Tiny & Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny & Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly. We also can move about 15, 20 cars a day through the shop. Perfect for you when the weather's bad. So come on down to Tiny & Sons Glass if you need your windshield replaced or repaired. Tiny & Sons Glass, 1-888-64-TINIES. Just call. Thank you.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Board of Selectmen in the town of Pembroke's meeting on Monday, March 6th. And we'll begin our meeting with a Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Watch that, Mr. Chair.
Put that picture back.
Good, I'm sorry if I moved it. Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15 and is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. We'll begin the meeting tonight. I'd like to call on a member from the Chamber of Commerce who is here. Come right up and introduce yourself to the board and the public.
Excellent. Good evening. Mike Morris from Remax Spectrum.
Yes.
And I'm a resident of Pembroke as well as a business owner in town. It's an honor to be here. So I appreciate you giving us the time. The Chamber, aside from myself, very excited to be in front of the town and be able to share what we do for the community and what our businesses mean. So I appreciate the time very much. I moved to Pembroke in 2008, built a home, coming from another South Shore town. I've grown up in the South Shore area my entire life. And I've learned to appreciate how much Pembroke has to offer. I have a wife, 22 years, and four kids, ranging from 6 to 16, with the twins being 16. And the town just offers so much that we love being here. So in 2011, I started my business here, Remax Spectrum, right in the center of town. Just myself, didn't have any agents with me. I was kind of from the ground up, putting the boots on and giving it a try. And today I have five offices, 73 agents across the entire South Shore and Cape Cod. And I'm proud that Pembroke has become one of our strongest offices and community we enjoy working in and being a part of. The most important thing about our firm, and everyone knows what real estate brokers do, we have real estate brokers everywhere, and the joke is you can probably bump into four a day. But we do more than just help people buy and sell homes. We're major advocates for the community, so we try to do as much as we can. We help 900 families a year buy or sell a home, and what's more important to us is that we're giving back to the community that we're doing business in so that people can appreciate the communities they're a part of, and that we start to strengthen the core of what the towns offer, because that equates to strong home values, and a long-term investment for people is their home. So it makes a big difference. And so we really, with all of our agents, we focus on making sure they give back, do a lot of volunteering. We also are involved in school and school programs, youth sports, and also with the Chamber of Commerce and the Family Fund Day that we put on each year, which continues to grow year over year. So A lot of people think that you just call on a realtor when you need to buy or sell, but really we're there for to be trusted advisors to our past clients and to community members in case they just need an answer to a simple question on what they should do for their home. They have a question about renovating or adding on, or whether or not their values are where they need to be for refinancing and putting kids through school. So the biggest thing that we do that kind of sews into the community is that we're publishers of the Spectrum magazine, which goes to every resident in town here in Pembroke and also in our second office closest is Plymouth. And we launched that about 2.5 years ago, and the focus really was about how do we share the message of what's going on in town. How do we spotlight businesses, spotlight organizations that are doing good things in our community? And it's a free magazine that goes to every home. So we mail today to 30,000 homes every quarter. And we found the most rewarding part about it is that, you know, people start to see articles about, you know, their families or things that they're doing in the community, how they're giving back. It just starts to bring people together. And you start to appreciate some of the things you don't realize are right here in your backyard. So we're pretty proud of that magazine. As I mentioned, it comes out quarterly. And we always ask for members of the community to share stories or share things they want to communicate out to the masses. It's a free resource for them to do that. A lot of the things that we get common questions on relate to just what you do every day for us as Selectmen. People are always asking about how the schools, how is the public safety in the town, our values staying steady in Pembroke. And one of the things that we try to do is just educate people, going to town meeting and voting on the important things that are put forth has a downstream impact to their home values. And I know it's always, sometimes there are difficult challenges that come in front of the town to vote on that you put together. But it's always important we try to communicate to our clients that it's important for you to see what the long-term value is, not just what the tax impact is today. Because the more you reinvest in your community, in public safety, in schools, in infrastructure, the more it'll pay off 20 years from now when you're ready to sell your home. You want it to be a town you're proud of and that people will see value in. One of the things that we always see is people are always comparing Pembroke to Marshfield or Hanover or Duxbury. And living here, I can say that I'd go to bat against any one of those towns any day of the week, given what we have for services and what our town officials do. It's just getting that word out. So we're always trying to be good advocates for our clients as well when they're searching for a home. It's not just a home for today. It's an investment for them for years. We handle residential, commercial. We help people sell businesses, sell their business opportunities, sell land, develop land. We also have a construction business out of our Pembroke office where we build new construction and do renovations and additions as well. So we're fully vested in Pembroke and proud to be here. So just want to thank you very much for support. I know many of you and I know you guys have been great advocates for the businesses in town, and we appreciate that.
Good. Well, we thank you for coming in, Mike.
Thank you.
The Board of Selectmen has invited the Chamber of Commerce to send any of their members to come before the board and explain what they do. And we've had several people come in, and it's been, I think it's been an enlightening experience.
That's great.
For myself, I do get a copy of your magazine, and I always read it. I find it to be very informative.
Thank you.
And it's an excellent magazine, very well done.
Thank you. Yeah, we have a team. Great team of folks, a staff of seven, and they put a lot of effort into putting that magazine together and soliciting information and articles, so I appreciate that feedback.
Very good.
We're, one last thing, want to make sure we point out, this year's Pembroke Family Day, the fun day that we do each year with the police and fire softball game versus businesses in town is slated for August 19th, so just save the date and make sure you mark it in your calendar.
Good. Yes, Dan.
That's a great point, Mike, and that's a great reason why we have this forum for the Pembroke Chamber of Commerce and folks like yourself at Spectrum REMAX, so that you, other real estate folks and other business members of this community who serve the community like you do for the Pembroke Family Fun Day can come here and have a forum to express not just your fondness for the town and what you do for it, but also to explore your businesses and get the word out. So I'm glad we have this forum, and I thank Arthur for opening up to folks like you. And thank you for
it. Thank you. Yeah, we appreciate it very much.
Any other questions or comments from the board?
Just one. Mike, where do you see interest rates going with the spring market?
We have a major problem with this market. There's not enough homes on the market. The rates are steadily increasing. Prices are moving right with it. So we're having a real problem with affordability. Before, you used to have 3.5% interest rates, and the prices were regulated down. With a shortage of inventory and the buyers that are in the market, it's pushing prices up because there's a lot of people trying to buy for the same properties, and now interest rates are causing a little bit of an issue. Every 1% rate increase equates to a 10% reduction in your affordability. So we're hopeful the spring market's going to bring some good inventory. We're about a 50% level of homes on the market that we usually are year to year. So if anyone's thinking of selling, they should call a realtor for sure. You ready to sell?
No, I'm here for life.
Me too.
Which I hope is a long time.
Yeah, me too.
Very good.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mike. Any other comments for Mike?
No.
Thank you very much for coming in, and we certainly wish you the best.
Thank you. I appreciate the time.
All right.
Thank you for coming in.
Ed, we have Chief Wall here. Is it too early to call on him to talk about his budget? Be okay?
That and he's got number item number two.
Yes.
The ballot question.
Yes.
Yep. Come on up, Rick.
Yeah.
The fire chief's here too, so I saw him earlier.
Yeah, I did. Chief Wall, would you like to address the board?
Good evening. How's everybody tonight?
Good.
Well, thank you. I think we're on for ballot question number four.
Yes, we are.
Actually, I kind of generated the start. I came in and asked the board of selectmen to look into how we could best serve the town of Pembroke with the results for ballot question number four, which was in future legalization of marijuana and retail sales in particularly. We formed a subcommittee. We met at the station a couple of weeks ago. Had a pretty nice debate. We came up with a suggestion, which would be to put a ballot question on our spring ballot to prohibit retail sales. And right now, the whole question of what's going to happen, how it's going to happen, the regulations all up in the air. The voters of Pembroke voted against it, although the state voted for it. And not seeing a lot of positive in that, seeing a lot of questions in there. The committee, not just myself, I came up with the thought that it would be best interest of the town to put it to the people on a ballot whether or not they would prohibit the sales, the retail sales and consumption of marijuana in the town of Pembroke. That's kind of where we're at. I sent something to Mr. Thorne. I don't know if he passed it on. It looks like he did.
Yeah, I'd just like to tell the public that when the ballot question was passed, the Board of Selectmen created a committee, and on the committee was a representative of the Planning Board, the Board of Health, the Board of Selectmen, Chief Wall, and a meeting was held, and a discussion was held amongst that committee, and out of the committee came what is going to be before town meeting about what our position is going to be. And the committee that was established completely agree with this article. We think it's in the best interest of Pembroke. And I'd like to thank the chief for all the work that he's done on this. It's going to be a big responsibility for the police department, no matter what occurs. And we certainly wanted you to be there to give us advice and from the things that you looked into and talked to other towns. So we felt that this is the best answer for Pembroke.
I would agree. A lot of towns have already taken actions, either through the Board of Selectmen or looking at bylaws, looking at different options on how to regulate the retail sales or prohibit the retail sales, so looking out for their best interest. And I think that it is in the town's best interest at this point to put a prohibition on it. Doesn't mean that people can't still possess and do all that. Doesn't infringe with anybody's personal rights, but it's going to avoid a lot of the the little loose ends that are still there in the retail business, we have no idea how they're going to make that work.
Yeah, I asked the, go ahead, Arthur.
I just want to ask the chief, is this kind of this year's adult entertainment zone, where years ago we had the adult entertainment zone and you had to designate someplace for it to go, or it could go anywhere?
I think so, and I think that if you know, a lot of other towns decide to regulate it, have a prohibition, it's going to end up somewhere. And, you know, we could end up getting a lot of, you know, issues from other towns in our town. And again, as far as the money goes and everything else, it doesn't look like there's going to make a lot of money involved for the town to do it. There's going to be a lot of cost to do it. So I just don't see it being in the best interest of anything. That's what the committee decided. Had a pretty good debate about it.
So your suggestion is we prohibit it altogether?
Yes.
Now, this will be an article on the warrant, which will be voted on at town meeting. And everyone will have a chance to debate it and to listen to the arguments for and against. And hopefully the verbiage that our committee has established will prevail.
So this is also an article.
Right.
This is also a ballot question that we'll vote on in the annual town election, just annual town meeting. And that's when he mentions ballot question 4. That's what he's referring to, not the town meeting warrant.
Right.
Number.
Now you're going to have to vote to put it on the ballot by the end of this month, correct?
Right.
65 days. So either you can vote tonight or we can have it on a future agenda, but you're going to have to make a decision by the end of the month.
Yes, Dan.
So just a couple more questions before we take any action, if we could. So Chief, a few other towns nearby or afar have decided to take no action on this until the state regulators can get together and promulgate the regulations, because right now they have not been, the regulations haven't been written yet. So some towns are taking a back seat and taking no action until then. What would your counter be to that?
Well, some towns have proactively already voted with their Board of Selectmen to take action, and in light of, you know, the wait and see approach and everything, I think that it's, you know, we have an option that we can put forward as far as taking this to the voters and seeing if they want a prohibition of retail sales. And you know, that's an option that has been vetted through complement page, things that the town council's looked at. I did some training with probably 500 other agencies, and they're all kind of looking at where do we go for guidance and what do we do is best for our town. And this is what we came up with, that this would be the best course of action. And this is what we talked about at the very beginning when the state adopted that ballot question, is how are we going to handle it for the town of Pembroke. And I just think this is the best option. And again, the zoning board should be thinking about future actions if at some point that we're not allowed to have a prohibition and we have to have a zoning in place for it. I mean, and all of these things haven't been, it's not clear on what the state's going to require. But right now, I think we're according to the council, this is a step that we're allowed to take.
And one more question, this contrary to your request, is the added tax revenue versus the true cost of servicing the town's needs, police and fire, in regards to having a host retail sales area. There are people out there that would say the town would reap benefits from the tax revenue. Mm-hmm. But there, the other side would say that, well, there are certain public services and costs to police and likely fired as well to service those type of stores. So what say you to that subject?
Right now the tax rate is 3.5%. I'm just not sure, just in our conversations with the medical marijuana, that the town was going to see a $30,000 profit. If for the first year, and I just don't see that as being an enticement to go ahead and you know, look at the added, you know, policing and everything else that we're going to have to add on that. So I just don't see that as being a good balance. You know, I don't know what the estimates are going to be.
Right. So, and I ask these questions because I like the chief, as the chief does. I feel that a prohibition on these retail stores is in Pembroke's best interest at this time. But I do want to know both sides, and I know I'm hearing it from you, and if there's someone else in the audience, I could ask them too. But I have had these conversations offline. But I did want to bring the questions up to you and the board here. So I'll let everyone else discuss it, but that's how I feel at this point.
Matthew, you were on the committee. Did you want to add anything, anything new?
Sure. So on the committee, we decided that putting this on a ballot and not making a decision for the town to either have retail or ban it outright, really letting the people decide what they want is the best course of action. So that's why I'm for putting this on a ballot.
Good. Anybody else, Bill?
No, I just agree with that also, that if the town originally said that they didn't want to vote in favor of marijuana being legalized, then why would we want to have stores selling it in the town? And I think the chief is right that it's going to cost the town a lot more money than anybody's going to make. And just because somebody pays you to put in a place to sell drugs legally or whatever, it's the repercussions of it, I just think, are going to be worse for the town. So I agree that we should ban it altogether. If we can, then let the townspeople decide.
Well, this board is going to have to vote to whether to put this on the ballot or not to support doing that. And we've had the chief here tonight. We've all had a chance to ask him questions and understand his thinking on this issue. So I think it would be a good idea tonight to take the appropriate action that this board would like to take. But I don't think we need to wait another week or two. So if the board agrees, is there a motion to put this issue on the ballot?
I would move that, that we put this question on the ballot for the next election period, which would be May 13th, and let the townspeople decide.
Bill, could you also include that any town meeting warrant that's required for this ballot question to be valid also? Because I don't see a town meeting article on here yet. So if it's
Article 21.
Oh, it is. Yeah. Did I miss it? Yeah. Sorry. Thanks. Yeah.
So that would include approving Article 21 as well. So would you like to change that wording a little bit?
Just add that Article 21 also on there.
Good. So we have a motion by Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Matthew. Any other discussion? All those in favor of Bill's motion, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. It's unanimous. Thank you, Chief. I know you were here tonight to discuss another issue.
Yes.
We have a few minutes before we have a scheduled appointment. Would you like to go into that now?
Sure. Sure. This is my fifth budget, you know, which is kind of interesting because I'm asking for the same people that I was asking for 5 years ago. We're trying to make some progress in the time. So I just wanted to go over a couple of numbers. Really don't want to get into particular shift strengths and everything else because I just don't want to tread that water. But we answered 14,567 calls last year for service, which is up 3,500 calls from 2006, 10 months. It's up. But the manpower isn't. As a matter of fact, we have less people working today than we had in early 2000s. About where we were when I got hired 30-something years ago. And I see policing just a little bit different, and I know, you know, when Bill was chief, I'm sure he was looking for manpower. It's been the same issue. We seem to be going through this year after year after year, and the town has grown tremendously since then. And the calls that we do, the calls for service that we go on, are changed. We do a lot more social work. We do a lot more outreach. We do a lot more calls involving drugs and mental illness than we did when I first got on the job. And every year when we get into the budget process, we get to the point where we don't know if we can afford to have new people. We're not really new people. There's spots that we should have filled years ago. I mean, we're behind. Right now I'm running, we have 22 and a half people on patrol, and we cover 119 shifts a week. So you say, how do you have a half a person? Well, I have 1.5 detectives. I have a full-time detective that does narcotics. And I have a sergeant that spends 2 shifts a week in detectives, and his other 2 shifts he spends on patrol. So he doesn't know what suit to wear when he comes in. I mean, you talk about being busy. And where I'd like to go with this is I really want to increase the patrol by 3 members. I'd like to add 1 person to every shift. Right now, when guys go to work on 2 shifts out of 3 a day, the minimum number that I feel that we can keep on the road, minimum number, is also what's scheduled. So anytime somebody's out, we have to fill it at 1.5 times. It also doesn't give the officers time to do what I call positive contact policing. They're reactive. We answer, we answer the calls. We do the best we can, but we're not getting that positive contact policing. We're not being able to do some of those things, get people in the schools to do the DARE program and to do those other things. And that's why we needed to get 1 dedicated school resource officer. But in order to make that work, we did hire a body, but I haven't replaced the safety officer's position. The 1 guy that we did, we used to go out and do traffic control and letting in and out the school buses and everything else, because I found that I really need that body answering calls on the day shift. So we're a department of 29. The engineers have come in and talked to us about the station and all the other things that we need, and they were giving us a figure of 2.5 officers per 1,000 people for a town of Pembroke. If you do the math, we got 20,000 people. We should be looking at more than 29 police officers. I think if we continue to go this way, we're just overtaxing the people that we have answering calls, and we're doing a lot of negative things. It's not good for the town. It's not good for the well-being of the police officers there. We need to increase people. Now, I don't know how to go ahead and do that, because every year I submit my budget, and this year I only ask for 2 people, because I'm trying to incrementally, stay within the guidelines of the town and the budgets, and get a couple people in the academy and start slowly to increase the number. Where I think it should be is at 36. So we're 7 people short from what I would consider a functional police department for this town to provide the services that we need. My detective, my full-time detective who does drug work, was involved in the 3 pounds of fentanyl that was taken off the streets after a 4-month operation in Bridgewater. He was the primary on this, along with the Middleborough Police. But he works with detectives from OCPAC, the Old Colony Anti-Crime Task Force, because I can only spare 1 person to do that. And that operation took several months, and he did a great job. I want to tell you something, I'm very proud of the work that he's been able to do and the resources he's been able to bring back for us. But one person isn't going to do it. I can't afford to move anybody else into detectives because I can't afford to take them out of patrol. My sergeant, who's splitting his time between detective and patrol, I mean, he does all the other investigations, the deaths, all the big larcenies, the B&Es, the sexual assaults. I mean, there's just so many other things. And in the department our size, all I'm looking for is to bring that up to 3 detectives. Same thing with patrol. I'm just looking to bring the patrol up to a level that if somebody's not working that day, I don't have to call someone in an overtime. And that lets me take that overtime that I have and put it into using it in the schools and using it on bike patrols and sending people out into neighborhoods. Because it's not the amount of crime that you deal with in a good police department and a good town. It's the absence of crime. So developing those relationships and getting people out there and solving problems before they become crimes is what we need to do. And I also really have to, for the well-being of my department, I have to increase the positive police contacts. 95% of people in town don't commit crimes. they deserve police services, and it's our job to make sure we get them out there. So I put together kind of a proposal where to go. I've asked to hire two people within the budget. I actually have a warrant prepared for two people, but I understand there's no funding, that no matter what we do, isn't going to be any funding in the springtime to take care of that and add two people. It takes a long time to create a police officer from the hiring time until they're actually able to function and do their job. I mean, the academy itself is 6 full months, 40-hour weeks. And then I require 180 hours of field training after that, which takes, up to 3 months in order to do that. So you're looking at 9 months if we could hire now. So I know I'm going to have a retirement of one of my command staff in September of 2018. So I'm going to ask, I still think I need to put the word out that I need these people. Right now I have it going before the town and asking people so they don't know what crisis and what we're sitting at. But I really need to put somebody in the academy in the fall. So the June academy probably is going to come and go, and I'm not going to be able to do that. But I really need to look at the late fall, winter academy, getting people in, because by the time they graduate, it's going to be June, July of 2018, and I got a lieutenant scheduled, looking at retirement in September. I'd really like to be able to move a sergeant up, get them trained to do this job before the person leaves, because it's the way it's supposed to be, a little succession planning. Run it more like a business than kind of reactive the way they've been doing it. That's basically it. I just, I put in for two cars. I'd like to get a two-car plan, and I know it doesn't seem like that's all that important and everything else, but we're putting 40, 45,000 miles a year on a car, and they're getting too expensive to fix. I need to keep them under warranty, and so I can get 2 years on the front line for the cars, and then the third year has to be on the back line, which gets about half the miles. And at the end of 3 years, the car's out of warranty in age and out in miles. And then I should be recycling these cars and moving on to get new ones. But you never seem to get past that one car in the spring thing. And then when I try and catch up in the fall, car's unavailable. The car I got money for last fall, I still don't have yet. So the cars that I wanted, the car I wanted to replace, we're still using. And it's over $100,000. So any repairs now, we have to pay the full price for it. There's no more warranty. But it's just trying to get ahead of these things, and it seems like we've been, getting a little bit more every year, but the cost to do business and the services is getting more than what we're increasing. I know I'm not the only one. Fire department has their issues. DPW's got their issues. We're all kind of in that, and I appreciate the opportunity to let you know. I'm probably preaching to the choir. You guys probably already know this and heard this, but it's nice to be able to tell the people out there that we want to do more. The police department wants to do more. I want to be more than just a reactive police department. The citizens of Pembroke deserve more than that. My officers are capable of doing way more than what we're able to do, and we need to do that, and we need to start making some increases to keep up with the population and to keep up with the job. So
any questions for the chief?
Well, I just like to say one thing. I know that he's talking about how many guys that he has on board today, but probably 15 or 20 years ago, we had 31 officers that was on duty all the time.
Yeah.
And when that went down, we've never been able to get back up to it.
No.
And it's not only getting back up to it. You're right. It has to go further. For the best services in the town,
right.
And I agree with you 100% on that, because it's always seemed, in the 50 years that I've been around over there, it just always seems like you're always way behind and there's never any money. It's like you really need to do the right thing, and I agree with you on the vehicles the same way, because it costs more money for transmissions, rear ends, and engines to replace in these cars than it is to recycle them every so many years. And we used to be on a recycle. We used to get a new car every year. years ago. It was one new car every year, and they passed that car down to other departments in the town. So Board of Health got a car after 3 or 4 years, the Highway Department got one, this one got, you know, and then they started buying their own new cars. But I thought that was a pretty good process way back. But we definitely need more guys on the street. And I agree with you about putting guys in the school and drug officers and all that. I can know now that some of the shifts that you fill today is what I used to work when I first went on the police department. We had as many officers working on the night shift as sometimes that you have to have. And that's kind of like way behind times.
Yeah, we have less on the night shift now than when I started.
And I'm not applying. So reapplying to come back. So.
And I'm not going to nights. I've already done that. It's just a process that we need to kind of raise that baseline up and everything. And I know within the next couple of years, I won't call them old timers, but there's some seasoned officers on there that are going to hit the age and the years for retirement. And it takes a while, so we may show some progress, but then we're going to go backwards. I mean, for about 3 weeks last year, I had 31 officers on the books because I was able to grab a couple of people, get them in the academy before some guys retired. And as they finished the academy, I had guys retiring, so the transition was pretty good. And that's what we want to keep doing as we grow. And I'm not looking to put everybody on all at one time and break the bank. You know, trying to go about it a couple at a time and start filling in the most valuable positions and do that. So any light at that end of that tunnel is going to look good for us. There's more work that we can be doing. And I think when guys get a chance to do, you know, they know they're not coming in for another short shift, even on the overtime, then we need to do that. One of the things I want to start now is I've gone heavy on hiring permanent intermittents, calling for the civil service list, taking people off of that list, and then have them go to the part-time academy. And then we're doing field training. We're bringing them in and doing that 180 hours of field training in the car. And when I run short on people, which happens a lot now, because people need their time off, we can use these specials in some patrol positions. As a matter of fact, I just trained 5 of them in the 911 so they can actually work the desk. It's an investment to do. But I also know that these PIs are the next police officer, so I'm not wasting that training. When we have academy spots, they're already ready to go. And I don't worry about them not graduating the academy and not liking the job when they get done because they've logged in a lot of hours. So what I'd like to do, I'm down to 3 PIs now because the last 5 people that I've hired have come off the 8 when I originally hired PIs. I'd like to call for civil service and get this current list in hire as many as 4 PIs and get that going, because I need to have another, I need more bench, I need another possum, so I need to have, you know, people ready to go to the academy. So at some point, if the town says, yeah, go ahead and hire chief, I got people ready to go. And the problem is it's not really ready. I'll know that they're ready to become cops. They still have to get physicals. They still have to do a state physical aptitude test, and that takes time. And then you have to make sure there's a seat in the academy. So it's a June academy now. I'd be lucky if you told me tonight, go ahead and do it, to get them physicals, PATs, and get them a seat in the academy. Probably could be done. But every week that ticks off, that becomes less and less. So I'm shooting towards the fall or to winter. And again, maybe the budget's different in the fall. It always seems like we have some money to do things, and I realize it's for capital. But if there's never a good time to do annual expenses, then we'll never do it. And we have to do it at some point. So I'm willing to wait until the fall to try and get some bodies in the academy. But I gotta tell you, even the time frame on that becomes next June or July, that they become police officers. And that's at July of 18. And again, I have somebody looking at retirement, possibly September of 18. So I'm not gonna show that much of a gain, but it's a small step, and we have to start stepping at some point.
Question,
I have a question, that's right. And I don't remember whether it was under Bill's administration or Chief Orenberger, but we hired 2 or 3 officers from other towns.
Yeah.
And I'm not suggesting that we pilfer police officers from other towns, but Pembroke seemed to be an attractive place to go. you know, we're a good community, not that the others weren't. But is there a reason that we don't look to hire from outside the department?
So here's my thought on it. We've built a pretty good team with the PIs. We get a chance to really test them out. They do 180 hours with our field training officers. And then they work shifts on top of, they can work details and everything else. But when we need them on the midnight on Sunday, Saturday night, Sunday morning, they work those shifts. And I think they're committing to us, saying, yeah, I want to be a police officer in the town of Pembroke. I'm going to take my name off of that open list. And our job is to train them and put them in here. And it's even better because we're getting Pembroke people that want this. So I think there's a level of commitment. Not saying that you wouldn't get that from other people, because our laterals have done extremely well. And I just prefer to create our own system.
Is there residential preference? Is that?
Yeah, it's still civil service, still gives residential preference, veterans preference. So we're getting Pembroke people. I think that's what we want. We have the ability to get good people from our own stock. I think that's the way to go. And again, we spend a lot of time with them. We invest a lot in them. They invest a lot in us. So you have that kind of commitment. And that's really important to me. You want community police officers. I don't think that you get a better one from your own community.
Very good.
Yeah, I agree.
So, Chief, how many people would you be looking to put into the academy, and what would be the cost for the town?
So, I was looking for $116,000 and change to put two in June, and that would start, that would be for the year, for July, based on the base salaries and everything else. In the fall, it would be different because we're only looking at, anywhere from 8 to maybe even as less as 6 months for the fiscal year. So it would be less than that. Again, if I had to put them in and start paying from July 1st, then it was 116,482 or somewhere around there, base salaries and two. And I would outfit and take the academy out of other line items in the budget.
And also, I'd like to know the town administrator has thoughts on this and what the Finance Committee would have thoughts on this.
Well, right now, as I mentioned to the advisory board and to the department heads on Friday, it's balanced using a lot more in local receipts than Mr. Buckley and I would recommend normally. In order to have a balanced budget as of right now, we really had to exceed our recommendations for local receipts, meaning motor vehicle excise, cell tower rentals, the building permits, anything that's generated by town departments. And we've added approximately almost $1 million to that line item. If you look at the sheet that I handed out with my budget message, if you look at the next to the last page and the last page, you'll see the summary of the budget. In discussing all this with the major department heads, we have several scenarios. Number one, we could ask for an operational override right now, and that would be probably close to $2 million. We could do as the chief suggests, wait, and in order to do it right, we department heads believe, along with Mr. Buckley, that possibly an operational override a year from now would be more in order. That would give us a whole year to go ahead and get the word out. I mean, and this would include the schools as well, because right now, Rick's request, Chief Hill's request, Gene Fulmini's request, we're all right now in excess of $1.5 million, along with the schools. And so those are options that we've been discussing. There's no getting around it, because we are using over $600,000 in free cash, which is money left over from last year that we're using to balance next year. And we haven't done that if ever. And so the only pot of money that's still out there to use is stabilization. And I know nobody wants to go down that road right now because we've been able to increase that. But these are hard decisions that are going to have to be made in the next month and a half.
Even with that scenario of using $600,000 in free cash, that still assumes that your rosy projections for the incoming revenue are accurate.
Yeah, well, you know, it's kind of like a safe assumption because we used actual FY16. So it's not like we're projecting out. We're just using what we collected last year for next year.
Okay, so not like the Plymouth County Commissioners. We're trying to keep
that. Oh, yeah, yeah. I couldn't in all conscience add anything more to that particular category, and I'll be happy to explain that to any of the selectmen that want to have a more detailed version after you look at what I gave you folks tonight and explain to you that there's four major categories for revenues, and the one that we have some control over is local receipts and available funds, and available funds is where the free cash is sitting right now.
So if I may, so if I could bring this back to the chief, so that information is sobering to us. As you know, this board wants to help the police department, all the public safety and services departments do the best that they can to serve the community to the best of your ability. And I understand your predicament. It seems that this year we want to help you move forward, but it looking to me like the fall would be the best option to do that, but yet help the town who's strapped for money at the moment.
Well, I think that's what I'm asking for. I've gone, you know, we sit down with it, and all the department heads sit down together, and we usually, you know, it's always been up front, this is what we got, and this is what we can do, and we haven't had an opportunity to do that. And you know, unfortunately, when we take care of things and live with what we have, we're not really putting out what we need, you know, and this isn't what I want. This is what the town needs, you know, it's the way things are. So what I was kind of hoping, at least to get the message out, because if this is the first time you're hearing that we're short people, this isn't the first time I've said it. Again, this is my fifth budget. And I've come in, you know, and I was looking for four people before, and finally this year I says, listen, I'm never going to get four. I could do better with two. It's not perfect. What I really need is seven to put us up where we should be. Still below the standards of everybody else, but seven, to me, we would have a very functional police department. And I know it's not going to all happen at one time. So I was looking at two. So even if that's 600,000 or the million or whatever, that's, again, I'm looking at very short term, just to handle and to make some forward progress. But again, at least if I get the word out, and then in the fall, before we spend money on other things, we look at what I consider this to be a critical issue, and if we can take care of it, then, you know, I can live with that, and my department can live with that. You know, and again, I look at, you know, academies and everything else. I got to do a lot of forward planning in order to make things work, you know, and I appreciate the town stepping up and putting the extra person off for us for the school resource officer. That was a tremendous thing. I talked to him. He's doing a great job down the school. He's starting to feel very comfortable. My kids are feeling, you know, very comfortable with him. He said he's getting busy, and that's good. There's people coming in. They're comfortable with him being there, and that's exactly what we wanted to do. But now it's, you know, that's one population. Now I've got to get the guys into the rest of the town and not just answer calls when they come in, because that's just not enough. And it's wearing on the mental health of people to always come in and it's just, you know, call after call after call. So I just want to give you the state of the state, let you know where we're at. Again, you know, I appreciate you guys who have always been supportive of the police department, and I just wanted to let you know where we're really at, where we should be going, and if we can get there, that's great.
Chief, could you just clarify for me one thing? If you requested two additional police officers, and that happened,
yep,
am I correct that in 2018, you're going to have two officers retiring?
Yeah, at least one, and then one in the by the end of that fiscal year.
So then we'll be back to
right to back
the same situation.
We've hired 8 people since I started, but we're right back where we started from.
Right.
But I think we're getting to that point where it's a younger department, and there's a couple of us old guys left, and some of us are staying for a while. So don't laugh, because I was a young guy when I started.
Well, just kind of
funny to hear you say you're the old guy, and they got young guys too.
Well, just speaking about the manning issue, if you need two now,
right.
In 2018, we're right back to two short.
Well, again, if we could do it progressively and be able to plug two in here and then, you know, and start doing
right.
it until we get to where we're going, we're not breaking the bank. I'm not trying to put, you know, 7 guys in the academy at one time and then they're all going to retire at the same time. And you know, that would be a lot of change. Not that I wouldn't like it, but it's asking an awful lot.
Yeah, I guess my point is that two is not really the final answer.
Well, 4 years in a row I asked for 4. And it's not happening.
Right.
So I thought, let's try 2. Maybe the 116,000 and change will be something that is attainable and we can go from there. You know, it's a much smaller part of the budget.
Okay.
And it would help. It would make a difference. Be able to, you know, it would have an impact on the department.
Okay, any other questions for the chief? Thank you very much, chief.
No, thank you very much.
For your time.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Have a great night.
You too.
We're running a little late. We had a 7:30 appointment with Arrow Restaurant. Do we have the gentleman from Arrow with us? Thank you. Would you come right up front, please? James Costello?
I am.
Good. Nice to see you.
Thank you.
So what we have before us is that Arrow is requesting a change of manager from Dennis Dunphy to James Costello. And we have before us all the required paperwork that has been put together, and it's all in order. And so we welcome you here before us. And did you have anything you wanted to tell the board?
Just to add to that, I did go ahead and get TIP certified as part of that program as well to you know, further my education and responsible serving. I really enjoyed the past couple of months doing business in the town.
Very good. Well, we've had several people that we know have gone there and have been happy about it, so it's nice to have your restaurant open at that location. And we've always had a restaurant there of one type or another, and so it's we welcome the opportunity of having Arrow in the town of Pembroke.
Thank you.
It's great. Does anyone have any questions for Mr. Costello? Arthur?
No, I'll move to grant when the time is appropriate. I just don't want to overstep on my colleagues if they have questions for Jim. But Jim and Sharon have done a great job in, you know, the original partners as well, in making a beautiful place out of a building that had some local historical significance, not to be confused with the, you know, the real historical properties. But that's been, as Bill can testify, it was the Habermock Inn, it was Johnny Yee's, it was Lake Palace, it's been Oliveira's, it's been several restaurants, but it's got a good look to it now, and the deck is beautiful, and the food is good. So I think it's the kind of business we want to support in town. So if nobody else has anything to add, I'll move that we grant the transfer.
Any other questions or comments?
I'll just second the motion.
Okay, hearing none, Arthur, you go ahead, the floor is yours. Making a motion?
I would move that we grant the transfer of the license to Jim Costello.
Motion by Arthur. Is there a second by Bill? All those in favor of the transferring the license, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. Thank you very much, and the best of luck to you.
Thank you all.
Okay, good night.
Good luck.
Well, we have before us articles to be included in the annual warrant. And the information we have says that Articles 1 through 10 are routine annual articles. Articles 29 through 32 are citizen petition articles. And the other 18 articles are here also in front of us. And if anyone would like to discuss any of them tonight, we can do that. We can just vote to accept these articles that are before us to be included in the warrant, and there'll be further discussions at future meetings of the board.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that Articles 1 through 10 being routine annual articles, that they be included in the warrant.
Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. Any questions? All those in favor of Articles 1 through 10, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. So, Articles 1 through 10 will be included in the annual warrant. Articles 29 through 32 are petition articles.
Well, just as a formality, Mr. Chairman, I would move that we include Articles 29 through 32. They're citizens' petitions, may be included nonetheless, but...
Correct. Correct. Thank you, Arthur. I have a second by Bill. So we have a motion and a second to officially include Articles 29 through 32, even though they are petition articles, but we will grant that they be included. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. Now, the remaining 18 articles, if the board would like to take some time tonight and discuss any one of them, we can. We can just vote to include those and schedule further discussion will be taking place later. Do I have a motion then to include the remaining 18 articles for inclusion in the annual warrant as submitted?
I move to table that for one meeting to give us a chance to go over these and get some input from the public as well.
Okay.
Second.
And there's been a second to Arthur's motion. Is there any questions or discussion from the board on that motion? Hearing none, all those in favor to table the remaining 18 articles for inclusion in the annual warrant, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, that's so voted. Thank you. The next item on our agenda would be a discussion of a new environmental policy, and I will call on Matthew to give us a rundown on his request.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I've put before you gentlemen a new environmental policy, and the purpose of this policy is to raise engagement and interaction between the people of Pembroke and us. Any idea that is realistic and feasible to improve the quality of our environment shall be considered by the board. However, I was thinking that we could create a secondary committee to consider the ideas before they come here, if that's agreeable to you.
Agreeable to me. Any questions from the board on this environmental policy that Matthew was proposing? None. So, would you like to make a motion?
I will. I move we adopt the new environmental policy.
Second.
Second motion by Matthew, second by Arthur. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of the adoption of a new environmental policy for the town, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. Deem that to be so voted. So you will continue to take the forefront on this issue for us then?
Definitely.
Matthew, thank you. The next issue before us is the Old Colony Planning Council has advised the town of Pembroke that we need to make a choice from the Metropolitan Area Planning Council and Old Colony Planning Council, and we have before us the Planning Board Chairman and the DPW Chairman, and the Director have provided us an analysis of the best interests for the town, and they have voiced their support that we vote to have the Old Colony Planning Council, and have given us examples of why they are more advantageous to the town than the Metropolitan Area Planning Council. So,
well, Mr. Chairman, we've got the expert at this sitting at the table with us, and I'd like to hear what Dan's got to say.
He is. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. I am I'm Pembroke's delegate to the Old Colony Planning Council, so certainly intimate with this information. So, for the public, for the board and the public's information, because of the way the planning councils are mapped, we happen to lie in a geographic area where we can be members of both. The Metropolitan Area Planning Council, which is Boston and suburbs, as well as the Old Colony Planning Council based out of Brockton and generally Plymouth County and Bristol County. So we can reach out to both councils for planning advice as we plan our town projects, traffic considerations, build out considerations, what have you. But when it comes time, for the actual application for to get on the TIPS program for road work, we need to have a Metropolitan Planning Organization, which is an arm of both of these planning councils. We've used both in the past, but we've used Old Colony Planning Council predominantly for the larger projects that we've done, the Route 14 project. We're working with them on the Pleasant Street Lights, for instance, the Route 36 projects, which is in the works. So we have plans ongoing and in the books through the TIP program with the Old Colony Planning Council. So it's our option as a Board of Selectmen to choose one or the other. There's a new federal regulation, a federal guideline, that states that we can only be a member of one. So it's our choice which one we want to be. I think that a smaller regional local council like the Old Colony Planning Council is right for Pembroke rather than an urban environment Metropolitan Planning Council. So I think it's an easy decision for us to make to choose Old Colony Planning Council. I did have a greater question than this, because I think that's, on the face of it, very simple. And judging on the DPW, the Planning Board's recommendations, that just lends credence to that. But the other larger question, and I'll ask Ed, we can remain part of the planning councils, both. Is there a benefit to us for that? Should we? First of all, what is the cost for the town?
About $5,000 a year.
For each. And we don't have to choose that now. We do have to choose the metropolitan part now. But the regional council, we can opt out of one or the other if we like. Save the town $5,000, but I'd like to know the benefits first. Does the benefits outweigh the $5,000? And if we don't use them, then what's the point of remaining in two different planning councils? So that's something we can think about. We'll get some information from Ed on that. I'll get a little more information from both the MAPC and the Old Colony Planning Council for a future date. I just wanted to plant that seed in your mind. But for tonight, when we're done discussing this, I'd like to move that the Pembroke become a sole member of the Old Colony Planning Council, MPL. But I'd like to hear your thoughts first.
If that's a motion, I'll second it.
That is the motion, then.
Okay. Motion by Dan, a second by Arthur. Any comments from the board? I'd just like to say that since I've been a selectman, we have worked with Old Colony Planning Council on many issues, and one that I particularly was involved with was with truck exclusions, and they certainly have got a history of working with and helping the town of Pembroke. So hearing Dan's explanation of the difference between the two, I would have no issue agreeing with that motion. So if anyone else has any comments, hearing none, I will ask for a vote on the motion by Dan, second by Arthur. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, hearing none, I rule that to be a unanimous decision by the board. We have a resignation in front of us from the community preservation. Diane Buchesny, I hope I'm pronouncing her name correctly. She has resigned her position as the selectman's representative to the Community Preservation Committee. So when I have a motion.
I would move we accept the resignation of Diane Buchesny as selectman's rep to the CPC.
Second.
Motion by Arthur and a second by Bill. All those in favor of accepting the resignation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, hearing none, I rule it to be unanimous.
I move that Arthur Boyle pronounce all names before anyone else in this
board. That's a good idea, Dan. Very good idea.
It's radio experience. It comes with pronouncers.
That was excellent, Arthur. Thank you. Now, the lady was the selectman's representative. So we need to nominate and replace a representative to be on the Community Preservation Committee representing this board. So if we're not ready to do that now, we could put that on the agenda for next week. How's that sound?
On our website as well.
And on the town website as well. Correct. Okay, so we will do that.
Can that be a member of the Board of Selectmen?
No.
You looking for another night out?
I just asked a question. Can it be?
I'll get an answer for you.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. So we'll ask Ed to give us an answer and we'll have it for next week. Okay.
Well, all of the other. All of the other departments have a somebody present. So conservation appoints theirs. All these other different departments appoint theirs. So I don't even know this Diane whatsoever, and she's representing me at one of these CPC meetings. So my thought is that if there is a Board of Selectmen member that wants to do that, it would only make sense that one of us do it and not have somebody represent us. Because I don't ever remember her coming before the board or talking to us about
I don't either.
Anything that has anything to do with CPC. So,
okay, so we'll put this as an agenda item for next week. And
we put that off for 2 weeks?
2 weeks?
Yeah.
Sure.
I think next week is not only going to be busy with these other things that we're going to do, but I may be late next week. I would like to be present to hear that before we make a decision.
Sabrina, could we add that item 2 weeks from tonight rather than next week? Thank you. We have another resignation to deal with this evening. We have an email from Greg Walsh, who is a member of the Conservation Commission, and he is resigning his position on that board effective immediately.
Move we accept the resignation from the Conservation Commission.
Okay. Motion by Arthur and a second by Bill. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, hearing none. Unanimous. Thank you. We have two requests from the board. Well, the first one is from the South Shore Race Management. they would like to hold a fifth annual USA Health and Fitness 5K road race that would benefit USA Health and Fitness. The road race they're asking about is on Saturday, August 5th, 2017. The race will begin at 8 a.m. and the route for this race has been approved by the police chief.
Move to approve the use of the town road by the Social Race Management and USA Health and Fitness, Saturday, August 5th, starting at 6 a.m. on Harbormark, Standish, Lake, Plain, Valley, and Forest Street, with final approval from the police chief.
Motion by Bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Matthew. All those in favor of Bill's motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. That's approved. The second application to the board is a request from Anne Marie Winchester of the South Shore Race Management to hold a St. Jude's Children Research Hospital 5K road race on Saturday, August 26th, to be conducted between 8 a.m. and 9 a.m. This race will require approval from the police chief.
I move we grant the permit subject to the permission being received from the police chief.
Second.
Motion by Arthur and a second by Bill. Any questions or comments? Hearing none. All those in favor of approval, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. I grant that to be approved. Is there any old business anyone would like to discuss?
I do. Just briefly, I just want to touch on, we've been examining the areas of water in the towns from Oldham Pond to down through the fish ladders beyond the Heron Run out to the North River. And the water level is very, very low. Brockton has been diverting for several weeks now, and one of the problems that we're having is that last year they diverted so much water that, plus the fact that there was a drought after the water was diverted, that it became very hard for us to get the juvenile fish out last year. We don't want to run into that same problem again this year. I contacted the superintendent of fisheries. He was away on vacation. He contacted Brockton and asked them to stop diverting because the water level is already low. And in the general law, it indicates that there has to be 300,000 gallons a day going over the dam into the brook while they're diverting. The only way that we got to that point to find out what's 300,000 gallons going over the dam is that one of the people from Brockton told us that there had to be at least 3 inches or more of water going over the ladder area where the dam is. We measured that the other day and it was only between an inch to an inch and a half. So they're below level. So I contacted the fishery superintendent again and told him that to get a hold of Brockton and see if we could have them stop diverting, because there's not going to be enough water if we allow them to continue doing what they're doing. The spring migration hasn't even started yet and we're already too low. So what I'm trying to say is that there's only an inch and a half of water over the top of the gate that allows the fish to go up over it. So unless we get a lot more rain to fill the ponds up more than what it is, we're going to be in trouble to get the fish in, never mind get the fish out in the fall. So I just want to let you know that we're working on that, and I talked to Ed Thorne the other day about it, about getting a hold of town council and see if we can get town council to maybe do something as far as some type of an order from the court to allow 300,000 gallons a day, every day, all year. And if that's true, then they have to stop diverting long before we get to this critical stage now. So I just want to let you know that we're working on that, and we're hoping for the best that we can get them to stop diverting. They did, in fact, say that once we knew the fish were here, that they would stop diverting. We did send a bunch of guys out over the weekend to check all the ponds and streams and all that to see if they could locate some. There was some fish located in the south part of Mountain Avenue. Wasn't very many, but there was some that were in that area. And the reason they know for sure is because they netted them and picked them up and saw that they were herring. I know it's early. Last year we had fish coming up in March also, so there was an early group that came in. So we just want to do what's best for the fish and best for the town. And right now it looks like we're going to be in trouble even before the spring migration if they keep taking the water the way they are. So we're working on that anyway. So,
Mr. Chairman, at Bill's request, I contacted the attorney that's handling the water issues for us. She was with us in Brockton when we met with the water commissioners about our dredging project. And this was late Friday, Thursday afternoon when I had a conversation with Bill. So I talked to her Friday morning, and she was getting copies of Brockton's water management permit with DEP to find out exactly what recourse the town has. And so she was going to get back to me when she finished reviewing that permit, and she'll have a conversation with Bill and I about that.
Yeah, right now we're not doing 300,000 gallons, and that's definitely in the general law. So
very good. So you'll keep us posted on this issue, Bill. Thank you. We'll go to the town administrator's report.
I've got this agreement with the town of Hanson. I met with the town administrator today, and Sabrina and I had a conversation, kind of brainstormed a couple of things. There are a couple of things that still have to be ironed out, so I'm just going to ask the board table this for another week.
Okay. Any other issues, Ed?
No.
Thank you. Under Ask the Selectmen, do we have any issue from the board? Yes, I'm going to recognize our camera lady.
Just as a member of the public.
Would you give us your name, please?
Yep, my name is Bonnie. I live on Pleasant Street. This isn't a question so much as just a suggestion, but since Matthew brought up environmental issues, and thank you, that's awesome, I just want to make one quick suggestion for something that the town of Pembroke could do environmentally that would have a huge impact. Community composting is something that on the West Coast is becoming super popular right now. The East Coast hasn't been as good at adopting it, but so far the city of Boston has started doing community composting through something called Project Oscar, named after Oscar the Grouch from Sesame Street, who lives in a trash can. It's cute. Anyways, there are 13 drop-off bins where residents of the city of Boston or anyone can just drop off any organic waste, vegetable peels, coffee grounds, anything organic. That's all brought off to a compost site. And then I'm not sure what exactly is done with the compost material that kind of comes out of it. I'm pretty sure it's given away to gardens, community gardens. But that's something that's really awesome, and I think something that would be really kind of, not easy, but something that's really cool to implement in Pembroke. If we could start like a community compost pile at the town dump, because I'm pretty sure there is like some space there where that could happen, I think that would be huge to kind of reducing our greenhouse gas emissions. The big problem with organic waste in landfills, in addition to them just like taking up space, is that when they're trapped into kind of like boxes by other pieces of waste, they're not exposed to oxygen. And so then instead of digesting aerobically, they're digested anaerobically, and that produces methane. Methane is about 70 times more effective than carbon dioxide at trapping heat in the Earth's atmosphere. It is much harder to get rid of from the atmosphere as opposed to carbon dioxide, which kind of naturally disappears from plants and stuff. So just in general, by taking organic waste out of landfills and putting it into a compost pile, you're not only reducing the size of our landfills, which is big, but you're also making it so that there's less methane being released from those landfills into the atmosphere. And then once the composting is like done, there's like this like fertilizer type dirt stuff that's left. If the town could just like give that away to people, because I mean, you know, it's dirt, that would be really kind of helpful in reducing the amount of fertilizer that people use. Right now, fertilizer people put on their gardens, it rains, the fertilizer runs off into bodies of water, super bad for the environment. By replacing that artificial fertilizer with compost material, you're kind of getting rid of that whole problem. So really the only downside with community composting is cost, and I really don't think it would be that costly to have a compost pile at town dump.
Yes,
could I offer? It might surprise some folks that Pembroke is more progressive than we might appear, because we already have community composting at the town landfill now for tree bark, leaves, and mulch, not vegetable goods, not household vegetable goods, but for leaves. And we do that, and we do turn them over with the backhoe to have them to aerate them so that they can decompose, and it's free to the public. The public can go in. We have separate piles for the new, the medium, and the composted pile, so the public is welcome to come and take as much dirt as they want, or organic matter as they want. And secondly, we have another program through the Board of Health where we offer home composting bins. And if you contact the Board of Health, there's a small cost to them. I think they're about $40 around tubular device with a conical hood in it, so you can have your own home composting garden. But what you've suggested goes a little bit more beyond that, and we'll look into that further. But we do, some people would be surprised that stodgy as we might look, we are a little more progressive than some might think.
No, that's awesome. And I knew about the leaves and stuff that people could drop off, and I think that's awesome. But bringing it to other types of organic waste, like vegetable waste and stuff, I think that would be huge. And one thing that they do in Boston that I think that we could possibly bring to Pembroke is just have like a trash bin at like the library or town hall or somewhere else where like people go, where people can just drop off their vegetable waste, and then that's carted off to, you know, the dump whenever it gets full. I think that would be a lot, because, you know, it's awesome that the town offers like composters for people to use at their own homes, but people are really lazy, and people won't, not many people would be willing to do that, but I think a lot more people would be willing to just like bring their compost bucket to the library or wherever it is to dump it off. So yeah, I'd ask you guys to consider that, please.
Yeah, I'd just like to make a comment that at my house we have flower gardens, and we have been using our vegetable waste for years, creating compost piles in our backyard, and we've been really using that material that you get is wonderful for the gardens, and so I can testify that it is a wonderful thing to do, and it doesn't take that much work. But expanding it, as you've suggested, may even be a better way to go. So maybe, Matthew, that would be something that you could look at.
Absolutely, and I want to thank you for bringing that to our attention. This is exactly what I was looking for, the type of community engagement with this proposal.
So, thank you guys for listening to me.
Sorry, thank you very much for your comments. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Let's see. Under new business, we have a presentation from the fire chief, Chief Wall. Would you like to come
Hill.
Up front and
help?
Paul?
Hill.
I'm sorry.
Who are you?
No wonder you looked at me like I was crazy.
Like, where is it? Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
It's my turn to probably express the same concerns that Police Chief Wall did. I'm a little frustrated and a lot angry today, because I think today exemplifies just exactly what's going to happen in the near future. At 12 o'clock this afternoon, I left the station by myself to report a building fire. The reason I am late now is because we had another building fire that was not responded to with the appropriate amount of people, not even close. Fortunately, this one turned out to be a chimney fire, and the one earlier this afternoon was a good intent call. The time is now. We can't wait any longer from an EMS and fire department standpoint. In 2012, Chief Beenham went for 8 people. It passed on town meeting floor, and next thing you know, it went up for a vote, and it disappeared. Last year, I put in for 4 with Ed's budget. That didn't fly. This year, I put in for a town warrant article. Not really sure where that stands. I know the town's financial situation. I think I provided a pretty good out to help defray those costs, although there are still costs that need to be accepted by this town. And that's $170,000 to outfit and pay salaries, 50% of the salaries for 4 firefighters. We are truly getting into a worrisome situation now. We don't even meet the standard of the NFPA for a proper shift strength for a town this size. I'm open for questions, but I'm at a loss. I don't know where to go from here.
Can you kind of tell the public? I think the board is more informed as to what your situation is. But how many people do you have on a shift?
Currently, we have 6 assigned to a shift. Because of budget, I think we kind of figured out our overtime situation for this year, anyway. We have 6 a shift, so I try to maintain 6 as much as I can. During the weekdays, like tonight, Monday through Thursdays, we drop down to 5. Usually nights are a little slower. Apparently not tonight. Those days are gone where it was okay to run late. And, you know, in 1997, actually I'm going to give you this sheet. This is a pretty good sheet to have. 1997, we had 2,106 calls for 6 people, for the shift staff we have now. This past year, we did 3,073. That's 973 more calls annually with the same amount of people.
Thanks, Chief. Okay.
So you'll see, in that same time frame, our population has gone up, some 3,500 people, almost? Not to mention the explosive growth that's in North Pembroke. And I was sitting in a budget meeting with Ed and Mike 2 weeks ago, and 1, 2, 3, within 15 minutes of each other, ambulance engine, ambulance, and a cruiser. And the deputy's cruiser all went north within 15 minutes of each other. And that's in the middle of the day. Something's going to break. I like lasagna. I'm not going to eat it for a month when the town drops it off at the station because one of us has perished unnecessarily. Shift strength we have right now is starting to become dangerous. Plain and simple. One person responding to a building fire is unacceptable.
Now, am I correct, Chief, that one of your proposals to kind of try to help offset the cost of additional people is to use funds from the ambulance fund?
Correct.
And
it will take up more than 50% of the cost of the 2 firefighters, or the 4 firefighters, excuse me. There are certain things I can pay for out of the ambulance fund.
Right.
Okay. So half salaries are part of that because they are paramedics.
So I think that's important for the public to hear that, we're going to be able to take care of part of the cost.
Well,
anyway.
Part. So maybe this year.
Yeah.
Because
right.
Unfortunately, you know, the last budget meeting wasn't too very kindly to new requests. So I know everybody hates the old word, but something needs to break. And it has to be maybe that particular word override rather than, you know, one of my firefighters, myself, I responded alone today. You know, a police officer pulling up into a situation all by himself. This town has grown tremendously over the last 20 years. I'm twice in one day.
Yeah.
And this is an everyday thing. This isn't just today. This is throughout the year. Granted, it doesn't happen twice in one day, but now it does.
Well, we've heard
some issues from Chief Wall about the same situation. And we kind of talked about the financial status of where we are and where the budget is. And the only money that we have now would be stabilization money. But we're talking about an ongoing issue here. We're not talking about a one-time cost.
Since 2012, when Chief Meehan identified the problem. And he asked for eight. And eight's the number. Four is a Band-Aid.
Well, this is my eighth year as a selectman. I have never seen our financial situation as tight as it is now. And I've talked with Ed at length about the budget situation. And I know what he had to present to you as well as the other department heads.
I get it.
And
for a couple of years in the budget, but I'm
yeah. So
I get it.
What we're doing is we're managing the money that we have now as best we can. But that money is not enough. So I'm looking at this as a choice. It's a public safety issue.
Most certainly.
And we have to respond to that issue. And it's our job to come up with some kind of a solution to present to the town. And whatever that solution is, which is the best way to go, including the override issue, I'm not afraid of that word. I'm not overly optimistic, figuring it's a slam dunk to get the public to agree.
Neither do I.
But I think it's a job that we have to tackle because we have no other money. There is none. And we have to make that message very clear to the public.
I totally agree with you. And
so
we spent a lot of years taking care of our children. There's only one kind of child that I know that doesn't learn. And that's one who has perished because he isn't there.
Right.
A lot of thin ice around these ponds. No, it's all gone, but thank God.
Well, I can appreciate you. I will thank you for coming in tonight because
I'm sorry,
I can tell your day wasn't exactly a fun day,
and
it's a very
tone,
it's a very serious day, and not to be made light of in any way. But I think we got the message.
Oh, I know you get
it. Now, what we have to do is figure out what we're going to do about that message. It has to be responded to.
People of Pembroke, I am serious when I tell you the situation is becoming worrisome.
Okay. Well, is there any other questions from the board for the chief? Thank you very much for coming in. We heard you loud and clear.
Thank you.
Upcoming issues on March 13th. We have the surplus property auction results for the parcel on Bartlett Street. On March 20th, we have a public hearing, a street acceptance, Equestrian Way and Pheasant Lane. On March 27th, we have Mrs. Mathias coming in to give us a status and an update on the Hill Bog project. Is there any other issues that the members of the board would like to mention at this time?
I have one issue, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Matthew.
I'd like the permission from you to form a committee to execute the recommendations the budget committee put forth a few months back.
And those, again, I'm sorry.
The main one was to seek a hotel to go into.
The revenue subcommittee
yes.
that you guys formed in the fall.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, let's hope that committee can come up with something. I mean, we've been looking for additional revenue. That certainly is at least part of an answer to help us with our financial situation. I know there's some other issues that may or may not be coming up before the planning board about some
some other projects, but you know, when that would turn into something real, I don't know. Dan?
Well, as I mentioned the previous meeting, the planning board has reached out and applied for district local technical aid from the Old Colony Planning Council, and specifically for economic development. So the planning board will be working with the Old Colony Planning Council toward those goals, and you know, this board's encouraged to join the conversation in that, of course.
Good. Yeah, I think again that's an excellent idea, and we got the right people looking at these things. Hopefully we can come up with something. Mr. Thorne, we have a need for executive session this evening.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we go into an executive session under Mass General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, a litigation, if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigation position of the public body, and the chair so declares, to discuss clerical, DPW, police, and fire union contracts.
And the chair does declare. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Arthur. Motion by Bill. All those in favor? Dan?
Yes.
Matthew?
Yes.
Bill?
Yes.
Arthur?
Yes.
And I vote yes. There will be, I'll ask the question. We are not planning on any votes being taken.
That's correct.
After executive session. So when executive session is over, we will be adjourning. The next regularly scheduled meeting of the Board of Selectmen will be Monday evening, March 13th at 7 p.m. Thank you very much for watching, and have a good week, and we'll see you next Monday evening. Thank you.